Good morning, you all. You're listening to the Express Yourself Hour. I am your host, Dr. Rosa Milligan, coming to you with Straight Talk, coming to you live. We are live and in color. We want you to call your friends, call everybody you know. This is the show that they definitely do not want to miss. My co-host is none other than the wonderful, the awesome. I try to look into the thesaurus every week to find other adjectives in which to describe him, but he's none other than Mr. Keith Swanson, radio personality within his own rights. Good morning, Mr. Keith.
Good morning, Dr. Rosie. Like I said, I enjoy this every week because I get to sit at the foot of a master.
Oh, you're so kind. Well, you all, we have a great show for you today. Get out your pens right now because I know you want to dialogue with us. You can reach us here at 310-928-7733. 310-928-7733. Or you can email us here at innerlightradio@yahoo.com. That's INNER, innerlightradio@yahoo.com. Today, we have an awesome show for you today. A longtime friend of mine and someone, my mentor, someone that I just admire so much. And really because of his wisdom and because of the work that he does is what inspires me to go on. Because I tell you, there are so many days when I look at what's happening to our people that I really want to quit. And this gentleman is the reason for me continuing to go on. He's none other than Dr. Claude Anderson, president of the Harvest Institute and author of several books, including Powernomics, the National Plan to Empower Black America, and Black Labor, White Wealth, More Dirty Little Secrets, and the CD and DVD that people have long been asking about, Dr. Claude Anderson Live, Economic Justice for Blacks, Collecting on the Debt from the 1866 Treaty. And I tell you for sure, if you ever get a chance to watch this DVD, you will never be the same again in a very positive way. It will make you get up off that stool, wherever you're sitting on, do nothing, and decide to make a difference in your life and for the life for the next generation. Good morning, Dr. Anderson.
Good morning, Rosie. I heard from that introduction that I've done well in paying you for this propaganda.
You know, you are the reason for me continuing, Dr. Anderson, and I just pray every day, and I just wonder what, you know, what holds you up and what keeps you going. I know it's a wonderful wife that you have, because Dr. Joanne is just awesome. To find two people with the same type of commitment is a rarity within itself. But, you know, you've been out here on the horn sounding the alarm for years, for over 20 years or so, really 40 years. You've been doing it. Telling us like that it's going to rain, and it seems as if nobody believes it. I consider you the prophet of our time, an economic prophet, because everything that you told us that was going to happen to us as right. Black people, it did happen, and it happened in the year and time that you called it. So I'm trying to figure out. I know how much I glean from you, and I know how much my friends glean from you. Dr. Anderson, the elitists, or the one who are running the country, the black caucus, the legislators and senators, do they ever try to glean from you? Do they realize who you are and what you've done?
No, they have no interest in what I'm doing, and that's okay with me, Rosie, because I found out a long time ago that there are more field slaves than house slaves, so it doesn't bother me. And my only big disappointment is the fact that black folk have come to reach a state of what I predicted back in 1970 would be, and every year, and you're right, I hit it right on the mark of what's going to happen to them, but obviously they continue to listen to the people in the most visible blacks in the country. That means black civil rights leaders, and before that was black ministers, then civil rights leaders, now it's black entertainers. Now we've got black entertainers that all of a sudden becomes the most knowledgeable people in the country about race relations, so we hear them speaking out all the time, people like Steve Harvey and what's this guy, Tom Joyner, and the rest of them who know absolutely nothing about racial issues, but they're out there trying to be spokespeople for black folk. So consequently, I just surrendered, and I'm giving in to the realities of racism now, and I guess I'm pulling back, and I'm going to start spending more time, devoting more time with my own family, enjoying the rest of my life, because I don't know, there's a great disconnect between the intellect that black folk have and the emotional reactions that they exhibit. And I learned that from one of the major findings in my doctorate dissertation, that black folk intellectually know what they should be doing, but emotionally they just can't bridge the gap. There's a gap in their thinking, and most of the blacks fall down in that gap. And I found it out when I was doing a study back in 1960s. And I used to see blacks just, you know, wearing their afros and the dashikis and bumping their butts and bumping their arms and doing the fist sign and screaming black power and we're black and we're proud and going through the motions about being very black and realistic about black issues. Then as soon as a black got close to him and stepped on his toe, he turned around and called him a black SOB, which meant they understood the importance of being black intellectually, but they just can't bridge the gap emotionally. And there's a disconnect, and I've gotten tired of trying to reconnect them, and I'm giving up this problem my last year pushing these issues, Rosie.
You know, you brought a point. I mean, that's deep. When you say the intellectual disconnect,
Wow. I found that not only here, but on the continent, too, because of, you know, the thing that went on with Libya, you know, where we thought that... you know, the AU would stand up and as one and prevent that, and they didn't. And it seems like, I don't know, hopefully it's not genetic, Dr. Claude. I'm just hoping it's not.
Well, right now, I have the same expressions and feelings about Africa, too. Mm-hmm. I used to take trips in Africa, and you run into the same kind of mentality, the frozen state, they're zombified, hypnotized by... I guess the philosophy now, Mandela, and the Mandela guy after Martin Luther King, and I found out doing the civil rights movement that our leaders in this country really weren't deeply serious about elevating the quality of life for black folk in this country. What they were more interested in than anything else was just simply make themselves appear acceptable to whites.
Right.
That's all they really wanted. That was the whole push behind the black civil rights movement.
So it's been about socialization.
That's right. Being acceptable to whites and saying, if you make me a vice president of a white corporation like Time Warner, or you make me a vice president of the United States, make me a senator, black senator, I'm really going to go out of my way to prove to you that I'll be no different than a white person in that same position. And therefore, you can rest assured that I'll never, under any circumstance, touch anything that pertains to black folk or try to change their economic circumstances. And that's why the white society chose Martin Luther King over Malcolm X, because Malcolm X was Martin Luther King was much more acceptable to whites than Malcolm X was. And most of the achievements that came out of the 60s and 70s weren't necessarily directly resulting from Martin Luther King's activity in the street. What brought about the major changes when the legislation he got passed dealing with the white power structure, it was because of the blacks in the streets. It was because of the Black Panthers, because of Rap Brown, Stokely Carmichael. It was those people and Malcolm X that were raising hell, and white folks got scared with all the riots. And they said, we better deal with these black folk. It wasn't because of Martin Luther King marching, moaning, we shall overcome someday. And they still singing that same stupid song 50 years later.
Wow. Oh, that's really deep. You know, you said something. I was reading a latest book. I think it was called, it had to do with black women in the workplace, in the corporate ladder structure. And she talked about how if you did something that really stood out and that other people didn't like it, that other blacks in the workplace wouldn't even go to lunch with you. They didn't want to be seen having a conversation with you because they felt as if you were being cahoots discussing something that had to do with just blackness, you know. So I don't know. I see it, Dr. Anderson, on jobs where black people get positioned and they don't want to bring in another black person because they're afraid if that person doesn't do right, it'll make them look bad.
That came out of a policy. You're on track. Don't be hesitant in your conclusions. That came out of a policy that came out after the end of slavery back in about 1868 or 69. When blacks were permitted to run for office, and they started allowing blacks to run for public office, that's everything from being a little local sheriff to being a post office clerk to being running for the United States Congress. But they put out a public policy. This is a public policy that said three things to them, which was an extension of the 1750 meritorious manumission policies. And what it says in 1868 is that any black that runs that holds a public position of any sort he must ascribe to and must submit to three things. One is that you could not, under any circumstance, bring a group agenda to the table. You must count on strictly at what you do and what you achieve as an individual. He started promoting individualism in black folk. And that way that separates blacks from the other people. Even though blacks have been enslaved all those years as a group, they started preaching and socially engineering him to place his confidence and his hope only in individual achievement. What he did as an individual, whether he's a Tiger Woods or Oprah as an individual, not what he achieved as a group. The second thing they put on there was the fact that he could not come there with a black agenda. That he could not talk about anything other than what was for the mainstream society, what was for everybody. And third thing is that he could not come there and try to hold white folks accountable for all the, for 350 years of slavery and deprivation, exploitation, and everything else. And those public policies still exist. And those policies originally originated back in 1750 in what they call a meritorious manumission policy. It was put in place starting in South Carolina. And that was meritorious manumission policies were just the opposite of what you hear now. You hear people talking about Willie Lynch. They still can't get it through their thick heads that there never was a character named Willie Lynch. There was one person all the way back in history came out of Jamaica that was Willie Lynch, one white man. And yet they still talk about Willie Lynch, that a Willie Lynch ship. There was no Willie Lynch. And what that does, it superimposed an image of a superior white man who had the ability to write about two pages of material, and somehow it was enslaved black folks' minds for 300 years. That makes white folks appear like Jesus Christ or Superman, when in fact that Willie Lynch letter was written sometime in the 1960s, because some of the words used didn't even exist in the 1700s. That's not even 1700 language. Oh, and secondly, God. Why would black folk ascribe to it? That's meritorious manumission. Meritorious manumission said, again, in 1750, we will reward and recognize and find any black acceptable, whether it's in 1750 or in the civil rights movement of the 1960s. One, if he can demonstrate that he can enrich and protect white folks' wealth and resources. Two, if he can invent something that a white person can profit from. Or two, I should say, this is number two, is that if he protects a white person's life or saves a white person's life. And three, is that he squeal on, tell on, and will blunt or impede any effort by black folk to escape or run away in slavery or start a revolt. That was called meritorious manumission. That is a public policy. You can go in most states and go back in history, you can find it in the books. You cannot find anything about a Willie Lynch in the books. You can find meritorious manumission policies. So what black folk now are doing throughout in every level of government and civil rights organization are still ascribing to meritorious manumission. Meritorious manumission means earn your right to be acceptable to whites. And that's what the civil rights movement was based on, trying to prove to whites that black folk could be accepted, respected. Not that they would ever own and control anything, but all they didn't want to own and control anything. All they want to do is go into a white hotel, a white theater, a white restaurant, or a white school, a white university, a white college. That's all they want to do is be acceptable, never to raise the standard of living for black folk and the quality of life for them. And most importantly, to empower them.
And that's what we got. We're able to go into their places now to give them all our hard-earned money. Where your people don't work, will never get a job. If they do, it'll be short-lived. So we really did earn something, huh, that we can pass on to our children and our grandchildren. If we don't rethink this, Dr. Anderson, I just don't know what's going to happen to us. You know, when you talk about individualism, just last week we saw that in Washington when we had the black farmers there fighting. You had people there who came up there, Dr. Anderson, with T-shirts, talking about we support John Boyd. Now, we support John Boyd. What they should have been saying, what they support, is the black farmers who have been alienated and discriminated against. But we'll take something and make an issue and put it around a person. I mean, to me, I thought that was just ridiculous. They talk about you support a person, you support the plan. But Dr. Anderson, one of the reasons I wanted you on the show, when I received the letter from you that you sent to President Obama, laying out a plan for creating jobs, I thought it was just an awesome piece, you know. And, you know, as I look at it, because here we had a big day, a big job fair, the Black Caucus put on out here. People were lining up from 3 o'clock in the morning. They had the cameras and the media there. But are we a day late? And I don't want to bring gloom, but I'm just concerned. Are we a day late and a dollar short?
You absolutely are. The door's already closed on our people. You got a crack left, a small crack left. And if you don't crawl on that crack and force it open until it gets large enough for some blacks start passing through it, you're through. My next prophecy, as I said in my books all the way back, the next prophecy is for the year 2015. I said by the year 2015 that over half of the living blacks on earth, that is in Africa, the Caribbean, Brazil, and America, are going to die. D-I-E. You're going to die.
Hmm. That's Wait, doctor, that's, you said 2020?
2000? No, 2015.
Yeah.
You're going to die because you're going to die because everybody's moving into a survival of the fittest mode. I told you that in 1970, that by the year 2015, you'll be into a survival of the fittest mode. That means that the strong will survive and the weak will perish. And you're going to, the strongest will be based around three things you must own and control. Your equality, your equal opportunity, your power rests not having acceptance to someone else, and not having accessibility to their resources, but having and owning control of your own resource. And the four resources you should have been struggling to control was: one, was energy; two, was water; three, was food; and four, was medicine. And that's why, and right on target, we've been having, as of about 8 years ago, starting there and working, that we had 287,000 black folks die every month in Africa. 287,000 per month dying in Africa, lack of food and medicine. And now Somalia, they got the hospitals are running over with them dying from starvation and famine. 20% of the world is suffering from water and food shortages. And our black folks just don't get it. You go into these black communities right now, you don't own and control a damn thing of any value.
Nope.
Or you don't have anything to export. Those who produce and control, those are the controllers. You can't control unless you produce. We are nothing. We are 100% consumers and zero producers. We produce absolutely nothing. We've been producing at one time, we're producing labor. But now our labor is obsolete. We've been obsolete, abandoned labor class, and we've been replaced by immigrants coming to this country. Now you can't even export your labor. And what our leaders keep trying to do is somehow try to go persuade whites and other groups to provide jobs for us. We keep training our kids to look for jobs. We never prepare them to go out and produce jobs. Definitely. Everybody else, every other group, every other group.
Hold your thought for a second. Those who want a dialogue with us, you can call 310-928-7733. 310-928-7733. Now, Dr. Anderson, you gave me we have a call, and then I'll come back and ask you about that 95%, how people are working. Go ahead, caller.
Hello, Dr. Anderson. How you doing?
Fine, sir. How you doing?
I'm doing fine. Now, there were a couple of things that I thought that I would also address, too. In your first book, it talked about the wealth that is owned by black folks.
The dominant white society?
Yes. In 1865, blacks in America owned 1.5% of the nation's wealth. In 1995, and it could apply to today, blacks still own 0.5% of the nation's wealth. So what do that say about economic progress, despite all of the other stuff that they're telling you? And also, some of our so-called leaders talk about economic development, but what they're really talking about is white folks coming back into the community again. Open up shop as opposed of building from the ground up. So I wanted you to address that.
Okay. But
thank now you, Carla.
Well, you're absolutely right. Back in 1860, based on all the studies I could get into and analyze make conclusions from, is that in 1860 we had about 207,000 black people that were free, non-enslaved at that point in time. They were in quasi-slavery and quasi-free. But those blacks had miraculously been able to obtain 0.5% or 1% of the wealth of this nation in 1860 on the eve of the Civil War. Before the Civil War even broke out, they had 0.5%. Those 207,000 blacks. Now here we are 140 years later, when you got 40 million black folk who were supposed to have been free and independent for 150 years, and you still have one half of 1% of the nation's wealth. Back in 1860, on the eve of the Civil War, the same thing was true in other respects, like we're working. Back at that time, almost 99% of all the black people were working in white businesses, white communities, white homes, producing wealth and comfort for whites. Here you are now, 98% of all the blacks in America are still working in white communities, white businesses, white corporations, producing wealth for whites. In 1860, again, on the eve of the Civil War, in all the major cities in the United States, that's Savannah, Georgia, Atlanta, Washington, D.C., Philadelphia, Pittsburgh, Buffalo, New York, all in, look at those cities, and almost in, across the board, over 51% of all the prisoners were blacks. And here you are 150 years later, and still over 51% of all the prisoners in the United States are still black. You have not gained one iota of progress in terms of jobs, imprisonment, or wealth. And it's wealth that determines your opportunities, not civil rights, not integration. Integration and civil rights is useless if you don't own and control the resources. You don't have any money, you can't use it.
Yeah. Okay. All right, Dr. Anderson, let's take another call. Go ahead, Carla.
Doctor,
meritorious manumission.
How do you spell that?
Meritorious, like a merit. You know, like you merit something. Just
okay.
M-E-R-I, meritorious, meritorious. M-E-R-I-T. T-O-R-I-U.
I-U-S.
I-U-S.
Mm-hmm.
Are you with me?
I want to learn that.
Meritorious.
Meritorious.
Huh?
Manumission.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, yeah, manumission, right, okay.
Manumission
means freed. When you manumit something, you free it. And meritorious means you earn it. So what they're telling black folks, you got to earn. That's why I was telling black folk today, you got to clean yourself up and behave yourself and learn how to do this, do that, and do it and act like white people. Then it means you earn your something. You're earning your freedom. You're earning respect. Go ahead, though. I'm sorry.
Harry, did you have another question?
Yes, I definitely have another question. In fact, I have several other questions because I'm enjoying the doctor so well. He's so informative. He's really making the show. I would also like to say, Keith said something about this, the
Harry, I'm gonna tell you now. You're not gonna be able to ask a lot of questions with this phone. This is jammed back. So ask one question if you can get back in, because we can't keep people holding. They calling from the job.
Okay,
so
one question.
Real quick, ask your question, Harry.
Keith said something about is this self hatred between between us? Is that what word did you use, Keith?
I didn't hear Keith mention about self-hatred. I hope we stop using it.
Well, it was the rivalry between us, and he was hoping that that wasn't inborn, but he used another word. I've forgotten what the word was.
I hope it wasn't in our DNA. The lack of cooperation. It wasn't hatred.
Is that possible for it to be in our DNA? Because seriously, I even see something like that in the other groups, the African groups, I don't need to tell you what goes on in the news. And do you think that's possible? That could be a genetic? You use the word genetic is what you use.
Yeah. Genetic.
Do you think that could be a genetic thing?
So there can be a slight possibility that, what whites did throughout history, if you go back as far back and start looking at books about 100, 200 years old, you find that one of the things that white folk really appreciated about when they chose their slave was called docility. Docility meant that black folk have an intern disposition. It makes them willing to accept their position in life, their status in life, and all they want to do is be at that beck and call at the arm of whites. That was a term they always used, that he's a very docile black.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the problems we have not been able to get over now. See, one of the things I found out even in the Marine Corps, as a safety and survival engineer for my pilots and my squadron, teach them how to survive in combat and in prisoner war camps, was that one of the things we could not beat the North Koreans and the Chinese, because I don't care how many we kill every day, they kept coming. They kept coming until we ran out of bullets, and they kept coming with a philosophy that as soon as we reach you, even if we don't have any bullets, we're going to stick this bayonet in you. And we found out in Vietnam, when they had to pull out of Korea, that the same thing, we could not beat the North Vietnamese, because they had the same philosophy, that we don't care, that we would die before we let you continue to treat us the way you treat us, and we're going to keep on coming. And the rule came up with this in survival training, that you cannot, it is impossible in theory and practice to defeat a group who says, I would die before I let you mistreat me.
Exactly.
But see, the black folk have always been willing to accept their condition. They'll sit out on the corner and drink and smoke grass and sit up 2 steps from puking and anything else in the raggedy rundown houses just to say, I'm just alive. Other groups say, I'll die first. We won't say that.
Yeah. Dr. Andrew, let's take another call. Go ahead, caller.
Hi, yeah, Dr. Rosie, Brother Keith, Dr. Anderson, this is Carl at Long Beach.
Good
yes, sir.
I have to thank you, Dr. Anderson, because, you know, I've been studying you for a grip. And, fortunately, I've been able to pass on a lot. I know that feeling of surrender, but I had to pass on to some of that, to a lot of the young folks that I work around, who are highly successful right now because of it. We're in a state of war. And I'm glad that you brought that up. I mean, we're literally at the very edge of our existence right now. Is there anything else that I can do and us, all of us can do to show these young folk, because they don't have a prayer with 50% plus young black males out of unemployed and sisters even worse than that. What can we do to make sure that these kids have a chance?
Well, there are a lot of things you can do. First of all, you're going to make them aware of the condition that we're in and the dilemma and the crisis and the short time we got to correct it. That's the first thing you need to do. Then you need to give them a very quick understanding on how we got into our condition. If you don't have, mm-hmm. if you don't know how you got into something or where you are,
exactly.
you never know how to get out of it.
Mm-hmm.
That's critically important. And then two, you got to learn how to teach them how to, that the primary thing they need to do is quit seeking civil rights and integration and start seeking ownership and control of resources. And once you get those resources, learn how to use those resources to empower your people and to dictate what you want. And you can be, in a model, for instance, you can be like the Jews in this country. The Jews in this country, they function as a group. And they don't talk about one Jew being rich. I mean, all of them. They pull wealth and power together and mass it and pool it to be able to dictate policies around the world for how you dictate and relate to Jews. And see, we need to do the same thing. You can't. We got blacks right now just dying to get to Africa. They cannot do anything to Africa. There's blacks in America cannot help blacks in Africa. Poor people cannot help poor people unless you got some resources. Blacks in this country should be learning, be teaching their young people how to get control of resources. And once you get enough resources to empower yourselves, then you take care of Africa. But we still try, for instance, because if a doctor has to look at Oprah and Mike and Bill Cosby and Tiger Woods, they got a lot of money, and that they should be helped. No, we don't care. It doesn't make any difference. It does not relate to black folk. I'll tell whites in a second. If Oprah and Tiger Woods lost their money, would it hurt black folk? No, because they don't use their money to pool it like Jews do and create opportunities for black folk to acquire wealth and power. And therefore, it means nothing. We must teach our kids not to get out and look for jobs, produce jobs, by learning how to be producers. And you produce in those essential areas I told you a few minutes ago, in areas of food, water, medicine, and energy, and start building communities.
You came here about 10 years ago, and you begged African-American black people to get into the water business. You actually just... And that nobody paid any attention. And less than a year after that, we saw water companies springing up from every place. And
that's right.
More people buy water now than ever before. People even paying for system for water. And you told us.
I told them 20 years ago to get into the water business.
I remember. Can you tell us the story about this white man? Carla, stay on the line. Well, you told us about you on the radio talking about what we should do. And this white man from Mississippi.
From Harrisburg.
Can you let the audience know that story? Because I think you need to go and call that man, okay?
Yeah, I think I was on the Bev Smith show. At that time, she was feeding into about 6 or 7 cities. And she was asking me, what can black folk do to empower themselves? And I said, the first thing to do is cease being consumers and start being producers. And because when you use the word, I said, right now, all these advertising agencies are constantly bragging about blacks consuming dollars and how whites can get access to black dollars and get into the black community. That's backwards. That's stupid. You should never be inviting other people to come in your community to sell anything, because the word consumerism comes from the word consume. Consume means to be used and wasted. And it used to mean consumption when people are dying of tuberculosis. That's where the word comes from. You never want to be a consumer. You want to be a producer. And they brag about black folk got all this consumer power. But you cannot have power as a consumer. That's like a crack addict having somebody bragging about how much crack he consumes, so therefore he's got power. It's the guy who's selling him the crack that's got the power. And so, but I was giving all these philosophies about to black folk on the radio, telling them you got to learn to produce, be producers, to wealth and power. That's all you need to do. Look for wealth and power and own and control. And this one white guy called in from Harrisburg, Mississippi, And he said, Dr. Edison, he said, I read one or two of your books, and I've heard you on this show a number of times, and I totally agree with you. I said, as a matter of fact, I agree with 95% of what you say. He says, and I support you. He says, but I'll tell you honestly, he said, what you're doing will never, never work. And I was shocked with that, and I said, I asked him on the radio, I said, why won't it work? If you believe that what I'm saying is right, why won't it work? He said, for a very simple reason. I said, what's that? He said, because a white person have never said it was okay for black people to do it. Mm. And he said, but I tell you what, though, he said, since I enjoy what you're saying and I think you're right on the money, he said, here's what I'm willing to do at my own expense. He said, you tell me and let me know what cities you're going to be appearing in around the country. I will, at my own expense, take my own money and come join you on the stage any place in the United States. And when you finish, and right before you start talking, or when you finish talking, I'll step up to the front of the mic and say, tell black folk it's okay. Mm-hmm. That as a white man, I tell me it's okay for them to do the things that you're asking them to do. And I told him, look, I might call you. And I said, I might just do that. When I said that, I got a ton of calls coming in, even from your city, Los Angeles, where they said, Dr. Anderson, please don't do that. That would be an embarrassment to us for you to have a white man going around the country telling us it's okay. that he approve of what you're doing.
I just wanted you to share that story because I thought it was really, really interesting because I know how many years you've been out here sounding the alarm, writing the books.
Many years, yeah.
So, you know, something has to be done. Carl, are you still there? Did you have another question?
I was going to gear it toward to more of like what youth can relate to right now, okay? The Little Wayne generation, the things, how to go ahead and approach them right now are things that they can understand right away.
Carl, let me jump in there, and then Dr. Anderson, take it. I can tell you one way you can start. Everybody that knows somebody, a young person, pull them aside and see if they can read. Let's start right there. Because we have children in our own home because we're not getting calls from the school saying that they're doing bad. We are assuming that they can read. If you cannot read and write, I'm going to say that again, read and write, you're going to have some difficulty. And Carl, that's where a lot of it is coming from. So the best you can do is to try to find out what are their interests. And we need to be up at these schools because they're obsolete. They need to be teaching, preparing the children, the young people, for what the workforce is going to be in the future. We're just going along happy-go-lucky. As long as they're not in the game, as long as they're in school, we're satisfied. But what are they doing in school?
Right. Especially now because, you know, at work, I always tell them, you know, I always tell my children is that you got to be on the ball because there's too many perfectly good white people that are out of work right now. And they're going to look, and the system's going to look after them first.
And you have to look at the amount of businesses that we own, what Dr. Anderson is talking about. Mm-hmm. Dr. Anderson said that 95% of all other races work for themselves, work for people who look like them, and 95% of us work for other people. Now, if that doesn't turn around, we're done. Because a lot of the government jobs are their downside, and that's why a lot of our educated blacks went to work. So, Dr. Anderson, you want to expound on that?
Yeah, again, because we keep thinking that somehow the government owes us a job, and we're gonna. The government owed us a job. They paid us a job by using its power to enslave us for 350 years, and then Jim Crow segregating us for another 100 years. Don't depend on government to do anything that's gonna be positive for you. You got to do it yourself. But we still think that somehow we're gonna find a job or other groups can give us a job. No group of people, not Asian, Arabs, Hispanics, or whites, are gonna give you a job. They're gonna use their jobs for their own people. They create their businesses for their own people. They practice group economics and group politics for their own people. We're the only people that want to go around and get a job in somebody else's community. They do not want you in their business working for them. And why would a white person want you sitting in his office when they're talking about issues pertaining to white folk? Now you all sitting there as a black person at the counter listening. Why would they want you in their business? They don't want that. And secondly, white folk are scared to have you to hire black folk. You know why? They're scared to hire black folk because they feel as soon as they discharge you for any reason, or you quit for any reason, they're going to wind up with a lawsuit. They're going to wind up being sued. Yeah. They don't want you, and you got to quit begging them.
Exactly.
I've heard them say that. They say they fire other people, they go on and find another job. They fire a black person, you show up with Al Sharpton, you show up with Jesse Jackson. You know, I've heard this come out of the mouths, you know, of different people. So...
Yeah, that's right, and that's why they build their own businesses. That's why if you go, And I did a comparative analysis of one time in the Detroit plan, Rosie, between Detroit and Manhattan, and between the Asians in Manhattan and the blacks in Detroit. Blacks in Detroit was 90%, the majority of population, 90% in a black city. And yet they own less than 0.5% of the businesses in the black city. Arabs in Detroit own 90% of the businesses. Out of 146 gas stations, they own 144. They own the gas stations, grocery stores, discount stores, party stores, liquor stores. The Koreans own all the hair processing, wig shops, nail shops. East Indians own the 7-Elevens, Dunkin' Donuts, and cheap motels. Blacks own nothing in a 90% black city.
But help me to understand this. It seemed to me a third grader could understand that we could shut those businesses down because they come into our community. All we have to do is take one down at a time. If we decide we're not going to patronize any the beauty supply or wig shop in the next 10 miles radius, if we did that for a month, I mean, either they would either want you to go in business with them or they would put some money into your community. How can we be so, I hate to use this word, damn it, that's stupid.
Well,
we have the economic power, but we brag about how much money we spend.
Yeah.
I'm so sick of it, it just making me want to puke.
Well, you know what, Dr. Rosie, I come to the conclusion that black folks don't see themselves as black. They see themselves as a defective white person.
Oh my God.
That's what they see themselves. They don't see themselves as, you know, because everything they do, you know, from the way they dress to the cars that they drive, are a direct reflection of the greater white society. They don't see themselves as black. I really don't think they do. You know, but help me out, Dr. Anderson, because that's what I believe.
Well, you're partly right, because the other half will go to the other side. They try to present themselves as being an exaggeration of white folk, which means a white man wears a 6-foot shoe, they're gonna wear a 9-foot shoe. White man wears his hat, wears a baseball hat, looking forward to build forward. They're gonna turn theirs backwards or sideways. If white man wears shades outside, blacks will wear the shades inside. And we do it, we exaggerate. We're taking gold and put gold in our teeth, our nose, our eyelids, and our tongue, and everything else. We try to exaggerate rather than saying we don't have to be either extreme. We should be right in the center. We don't have to exaggerate ourselves to be recognized if we depend on our uplifting from what we are as a people, as a productive people, not because we're an exaggerated white person trying to get acceptance of being or trying to be seen. So they exaggerate their appearance just to be seen. But Rosie is right, though. Go ahead. I'm sorry, Rosie.
Let me just ask you this. This is what I have on my mind. Tell me what you think about this. I think the whole world knows that economic is really that piece of the puzzle that's missing. But you know what really I'm concerned about now? Because I know you have fought with the Black Freedmen, the Black Indian, that foundation. And I know how much your personal money, your family money that you have put into this lawsuit, that everything that's due us, and I'm getting angry as I speak, that we have to fight through a court of law till we can exalt all the money that we have, then they want to hand you crumbs. We didn't get the money that we're supposed to get out of benefits from the 1866 treaty. We did not get reparation in this country. And the black farmers who have suffered at the hand of our own government are fighting to get paid. Do you realize what it would be when they call us beggars and all this stuff? Do you realize what it would be like if somebody just give us what we're supposed to have, do right by African Americans? We won't need anything they have. We have farmland. We can go back and farm. We can grow. You know, we can feed ourselves. Do you realize how much land is owned in the South by blacks right now? But it's useless because they can't do anything with it. Help me to understand why we're not mad when it's like holding your money. It's like robbing you.
It's because you got image makers in this country that create and fabricate perceptions so that you see reality only in the way they want to see it. People see what they've been taught to see. People see what they expect to see. People see what they want to see. And right now we got a system that manipulates what blacks see and what images they think are appropriate images for black folk. They manipulate the language and everything else. See, if you go back to 1857 as an example, let's go back and track something very quickly. See, in 1857, in the Dred Scott decision, the Supreme Court says that a black man has no rights that a white man is bound to respect. which means he's not a citizen. He's not entitled to any rights. So by 1864, when a few liberals in the United States Congress decided to write a civil rights bill, they wrote it trying to give the civil rights means rights of a citizen. That's what it means. Civil rights means rights of a citizen, to give him rights. So they wrote this 1865 civil rights law. But they wrote that law strictly and solely for black people. It spelled out that the civil rights law of 1865 was written strictly and solely for black folk. And they stood up on the congressional floors and said, this is what civil rights mean. And Charles Sumner, Thaddeus Stevens, and Congressman Benjamin, they said this, that in this country, that a black person in America would never be any more than either free or he'd be slave. He always be a slave. He can only be free if he breaks loose after his war is over. We give him 40 acres, a mule, and $100 for every black that he must get minimally. 40 acres, a mule, and $100. And that was the civil rights law of 1865. Andrew Johnson came in, and President Johnson came in and vetoed it. And then they came back the next year and wrote it again. This time they minimized 1865 civil rights law, 1866 civil rights law, and they took out some of the economics just to get it passed, just like Obama's doing now. But at that point in time, then they took and converted over to what we call 1867, to the 14th Amendment, to make sure whites can never touch it again. But the civil rights laws of 1865 and 1866 and the 14th Amendment was written exclusively for black folk, to empower black folk economically. They said that civil rights is an economic issue. It is not a social issue. But we've been conditioned to believe that it's a social issue. And that's why we're talking about civil rights. That's why you got the Martin Luther King Memorial, so they can go in and march around and sing and hold hands and say, we shall overcome socially. It has nothing to do with social. It was supposed to have been economics. We've been manipulated and seeing things upside down and backwards, Rosie.
Could have put Malcolm X picture next to it and said by any means necessary.
Necessary, yes.
It would have made more sense.
That's a good segue, because, Dr. Anderson. What do you think about this so-called plan that Obama has, jobs plan that Obama is starting to put forth?
Well, I wrote a plan for that. It spelled it out, and I was trying to help the president. And I don't know whether it got to him, but people said they were delivering it to him. We sent it to the White House, and I was at one person even supposed to, this close to him, sort of taking it and put it in his hands. But again, people saying, and I saw all the write-ups by some of our entertainers saying, well, you know, Obama can't do anything for black folk. You know, they won't let him do it. Then you don't need anybody in the White House. You don't need anybody. That's why I tell black folk, quit wasting your time messing around with politics. Politics is totally, 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 absolutely useless. Voting is totally, totally, absolutely useless. That's a part of that mind control on you. That's what I was doing in the Marine Corps out in Hawaii, Bobby, going through special training for deprogramming our prisoners of the war who had been brainwashed. You're being brainwashed to believe that somehow politics and voting does something for black folk. It does not. There's no direct relationship between voting and putting a black person in office and black folk getting benefits. And black folk just can't get that through their heads.
Well,
there's no benefit to you.
In the cities that I know of where they have black mayorship all over this country, blacks are worse off than any race in that city. And you have a mayor who's running the city. So, I mean, when are we going to understand the correlation between that? And someone else, okay, I have a question for Dr. Ann. Okay, someone else have a question. Let me go ahead and have them to ask that. Go ahead.
Okay, you want me to answer this?
No, it's not.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Let me take the other person.
Good morning, Dr. Anderson, Dr. Milligan, Keith, and everybody.
Good
listening.
Morning, sir.
This is Brother Jamal here. Dr. Anderson, I'm going to share with you a perspective and just to get your response, because I've been criticized myself for taking what some would consider to be an anti-Barack Obama position. I don't want to see a black president of the United States of America, and especially when it's apparent that America is a sinking ship. I actually would prefer to see a white male be at the helm of this ship as it sinks. I think it's too easy for white America to act like it's practicing selective amnesia and blame all the ills and all the woes that America is currently suffering on the current black president of the United States. That's my comment, and I just want your perspective or response, sir.
Right. I can clearly understand what you're saying, Jamal, and I guess from an emotional standpoint, you want an emotional satisfaction. and seeing if the ship goes down that you want to be gratified the fact that a black person is not at the helm. I can understand that. But for black folks to be effective, and even for President Obama to be effective, he must have an economic base that he's responding to. Right now, he's responding to a non-black economic base. He's responding to Jewish economics. He's responding to the mainstream white economics. He's not responding to black folk because black folk do not have an economic base. And so if you want to save this, keep the ship from going down, Jamal, you must begin to look at our society in the terms of a five-story building. I'm going to explain to you very simply. It is not voting. Voting is totally useless. What you got to do is you get a five-story building. The first building is always economics. What you want to do is to build yourself an economic base. Your economic base is built inside of a given community, a community that you've identified as your business community, where you store all your wealth, your power, your resources, your jobs, your unemployment, your goods, your services, your history, your culture, your power is stored in a community. That's where you pool everything and everybody comes in, shop, and buy their money, spend their money. That's just like what a Japantown, Chinatown, Frenchtown, Germantown, Polishtown, Little Mexico, little Arab towns, Little Cuba. You got to have a black community. We do not have not one single solitary black community in America where we can pool our resources. So consequently, we have no economy. And therefore, we have no way of controlling politics. But if you had a first floor of economics, you then get your economics together and you get enough wealth and power and controlling resources on the first floor of the building. Control the first floor economically in your community. Then you take that money and you leverage it up to politics. Politics is the second floor. You take your money and you control the second floor. The second floor is whoever you put in office. I don't care whether it's black, white, green, polka dot. You then use your money to buy your politicians. Any politician you can buy on the second floor, you either rent or lease them and make sure you control the politics on the second floor with your money. That's what the white Indians are doing right now by shutting blacks and black freemen and black Indians out by giving money contributions to all these white politicians in Washington and giving it to the black people in the Congressional Black Caucus, too, to make them go against black folk. So you control the politicians with the money you make on the first floor. You control the second floor. Then after you get control of the second floor, you have those politicians to control the third floor. Your third floor is your court and your legal and your law for it, your law enforcement, your police departments. The reason people keep beating up on black folk and while driving while black and all this other kind of stuff is because you have no economy underneath you. The purpose of a police department is to respond to an economy. If there's a Katrina in New Orleans and people are breaking into the stores trying to find water and food, the police and the military go there. They're not going there to protect black folks. They're going there with their guns to shoot black folks for messing with the stores.
Exactly. So Dr. Anderson.
Yes.
Since you've drove that point home, it's excellent, and I'm sure our listeners understand it's all about that first floor. We have two callers. Go ahead.
Go ahead then.
Diane.
First caller.
Hello, Miss Rosie.
Hello, how are you?
Fine. And Mr. Anderson?
Yes, ma'am.
It is depressing when you see everything that goes around that's happening today reflects on yesterday. It's just like we have no rights. And all the rules apply from slavery time. And so what I have, what's out there now for black people is a club called African American .ning, that's NING.com, whereas we're gathering a group of black people to go to Africa, claim land, and then do business with the people in America. Now, that's one way out. And then we just pool our resources that way. And like the other day, I was trying to plant a seed, whereas all black people in one precinct just write in a black person's name that they favor and get our people into office. But then, too, you said,
yeah, that's symbolism, Diane. Yeah, that's symbolism. You know, being happy that we got black males in every city, and black folks are worse off because they don't have a black agenda. They're afraid to have one, and now we're really outnumbered, especially like out here in California. Black politicians, they're not paying us any attention. They're courting everybody else because they know we're going to vote for them. So if we can understand anything Dr. Anderson said, is that we need to pick up the torch and run for ourselves. And Diane, I don't want to cut you off. We got three callers. We're backing up. Dr. Anderson, can you stay 15 minutes over because there's too many people want to talk to you? Can you hang on 15 minutes over?
Right. And when you get a chance, I want to explain what happened, that disconnect between electing Blacks office and getting benefits too, Rosie.
Okay. I'm going to put a mark here. Keith, make sure he comes back to it. So, okay. Diane, he's going to come back and talk about that, okay?
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, darling. Thank you so much for listening. Go ahead, next caller.
Hello?
Hello?
Yes. What's your name?
This is Jim Klingman in Cincinnati.
Go ahead, Jim. You
got the man on.
No, I called to talk to the two of my favorite people and just to congratulate you and to compliment you both for the work that you continue to do for our people. I just appreciate it sitting here listening to you. Just wanted to call in and say hi.
Oh, that is so wonderful. You know, you're the man.
Well, I'm just, you know, walking in Dr. Anderson's footsteps. He left some big shoes for us to try to fill. But people like you, Dr. Rosie, myself, and others who've worked with him over the years, you know, we just really appreciate his long years of work for our people. And, you know, I just pray that our people will wake up one day soon and take his lead and move in the right direction toward economic empowerment.
Well, Jim, I tell you one thing. If they don't take his lead when he's no longer leading, they done, because I am not going to try to fool those, those
you
shoes.
And me
I'm
both,
about
Doc.
To quit now. You know,
you
only reason I keep going now because he give me juice. But if he stop, I always tell him, Dr. Andrew, if you stop, you got a whole lot of people who are going to stop right behind you.
Because if
you can't make it happen with all these books, you've laid it out strategic,
analytical.
It's not just what you think. You have studied this, have analyzed it. Proof of being in the pudding, you have prophesied what's going to happen. It came down just the way you said it. So if you can't make them believe, if they can't believe with you, I can't do nothing.
Yeah. Well, you know, I find that funny, Rosie, because a couple of people called me one day and said, Doctor, why is two things I want to ask you. Why is it we never see you on national television, point one, and why is it across this country we see all kind of banquets and image awards and these kind of awards? And why is it in this country in the 40 years where you've been writing books and being the bestseller and this and that, and you wrote the only national plan in America for Black folk in 1970. It came to call an affirmative action plan that everybody copied but never credited to you. You wrote a plan, a national plan for power numbers. You wrote a plan for Detroit. You wrote a plan for the president. Why is it they never recognize you? And how many awards and dinners have you ever had for you? I said, in 40 years, I said, I've never had one. I said, I guess that's because the field Blacks don't we recognize and reward people too often. You got to be a house Black to get those kind
of
recognition.
Dr. Anderson, you know what it is? It's one of the same reasons. I'm sure Jim shared the same thing, and I do. People always call them when they're having different things, ask them, did they invite you? No, because they're sponsored by other folks' money, and they're always afraid that I might say something that they don't get their sponsorship, because I'm going to call it the way it is. I'm not up there. Shuffling and talking trash.
That's
we're dying. We're in a warfare. So I can't come there, you know, with a stick in my words. I have to come with a gun, a tornado. I have to come with my oozes when I come before Black people to talk to them. And I'm not coming any other way, because not only for me, if I don't fix it, it won't be fixed for my children. It won't be fixed for my grandchildren. So I don't time to play.
Wait, you know what, Rosie? I spoke at the Blacks and the black employees at Ameritech in Detroit, Michigan, one year invited me to be the keynote speaker for their black history lunch. Was it either luncheon or a dinner? And this was a black history luncheon. And they had Ameritech had a black vice president. And after I spoke, I talked about issues about black folk and black history. They went and fired the person that asked me to be a speaker, because he said it was embarrassing for me to talk about black issues when they had some whites in the audience. And so they fired the individual who had invited me, Jim.
I know you're telling the truth. That's what happened, Jim, when I spoke at
Irvine. That's Ameritech with a black vice president of Ameritech.
Yeah. I spoke for the baccalaureate graduation for black students in Irvine. And the teachers, they were just enjoying what I was saying until I said I would be remiss if I closed without telling you all that racism is alive and well. You should have seen the coldness that went across that audience, because they did not want me to say that, you know?
Mm.
Go ahead. We have another caller.
Okay. I invite you to read that article I wrote called Pardon the Interruption. It's on my website.
Okay.
We're going to get to it.
Give your website, Jim.
What's your website, Jim?
Blackonomics.com.
Okay, will do.
And
thank
Rosie, you know what, Rosie, care, I'm going to tell you this. In Pittsburgh and in Richmond, Virginia, in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and Richmond, Virginia, they went into whites went into the libraries in the school and pulled my books, Black Labor, White Wealth, off the library shelves.
Wow!
Then said they didn't want black kids reading books about slavery like that, about following track and how they got locked into the lowest level of a real life monopoly game that they can't get out of and can't be a competitive group of people. And they pulled the books off. And that's
nobody
in Pittsburgh.
Protests. The sad part, did anybody
none of the teachers said anything.
That's what I'm talking about. Okay, go ahead, caller. We have another caller. Go ahead, caller.
Yes, I've been listening to your show. My name is Devin A. Unleashed. I'm from Los Angeles, California. And I was just wondering if you all have heard about the Texas textbook massacre that has been going on in Texas, where they have changed the curriculum for the textbooks in that state to imply that slavery didn't exist.
Oh my goodness.
That's sort of a wasted discussion. That's what's called a straw man. I wouldn't spend 2 seconds trying to convince whites of that, because at this point they're trying their best to do anything to avoid any guilt, and because if they accept the guilt, then they have some responsibility to do something for black folk. They don't want to do either one. So I wouldn't waste my time trying to counter that.
But they've already changed the books for the schools.
But if you got your own community, they can't change them. You have to understand one thing. Remember this. Remember that the schools belong to the local community. They don't belong to the state. They belong to the local community.
Right.
The schools are supported by your ad valorem taxes. The government, the federal government, puts in only 6% of the money to run the schools, and the states put in about 12 or 13%. The other 80-some darn percent is cut. 85% comes from the community. Don't let anybody else dictate what's going to be in your books. What the state is doing, the state is contributing about 12% of the money, saying that they'll give you 12%. If you put some issues that pertain to state history or that kind of stuff in there, or state proclamations or something about the state itself in some place in the curriculum. Same thing with the federal government. You tell them, no, you keep your 6% federal government, and the state, you keep your 12%. We'll run our schools off our local ad valorem taxes, and we'll put what we want in our own books, because this is a community. We run our schools based on what our kids need, not what the descendants of the slave master needed, but what these black kids, what the descendants of these slaves need in their books.
I think also that if they, as a society and as parents, as long as we keep the forefront and letting our children know our history, it's not going to be a problem.
Well, that's what you should do.
Let's go deeper than that. It's important for everybody to know our history. That's why they have no respect for us, because they don't know our true history. They don't know all the things that we have invented, all the things that we have been responsible for. That's why people look at us like nothing, because they don't see this. So I think it's important for history. But the thing that bothers me, and to the caller, I want to say this. I'm just amazed at what goes on in these schools. And these schools, employees, are the cream of the crop. They are out educated, the one we've sent to college. Why in the hell are they sitting still allowing all of these things happen while they're not saying anything? I don't understand this. It makes no sense for us to even have this issue about what they're trying to teach our kids, and we go home and talk about it. I'm so sick of this. I don't know what to do. They're in position to speak up, you know, because you're there in the school system. You know how they're miseducating our kids. The people who on common level, they don't even know you're there. Come on, what are we afraid of?
But Rose, see, you don't have communities anymore. That's what integration did. Integration intentionally destroyed your black communities. You have no say so over anything that happens to you now. See, back before integration, you had black communities. And in black schools in the old days, those teachers decided what was going to be taught, and those black teachers decided what was going to be taught in those classrooms. They set the code of conduct. Those black teachers say, you're going to come to school, you're going to learn how to spell, you're going to comb your hair, you're going to come here clean with a t-shirt, with a shirt, and you have a handkerchief in your pocket, you're going to comb your hair, you're going to learn your ABC, you're going to learn everything. In the old days, when we had our own communities, before integration came, those black teachers enforced a code of conduct for learning, for reading, for writing, and learning, and doing everything, even breaking down sentences and fragmenting sentences and everything. But they don't do that anymore, because now you're integrated, and now and the thing that's killing black people in America also is killing this country is globalization. See, now they got black communities reacting to what happens globally. If you had your own community, you tell them, I don't care about it. I got my own businesses. The only recourse that black folk got right now to survive is to build these communities as fast as they can and insulate them by producing their own products, services, and goods, have these black farmers in the South to start producing goods and services and shipping them into these black urban cities like Detroit, yeah. Michigan, Gary, Indiana, Pittsburgh, Philadelphia, East St. Louis, and providing food stuff for your own people, for providing water. You got major health problems coming. These people are start dying in this country pretty soon. And blacks got to start building their own communities.
If you don't come together mentally as a race, you're not going to, nothing, none of what you're saying is going to come together. We have to come together as a race and understand that we need each other. We have to build things together as a race, not just, I have a business, you have a business. We have to help each other like other races do. They help each other.
And you know what, sister? We're going to have to do something to those people who sell us out and do something to those people who are in position to help. And because they are comfortable in their neighborhood and their houses, they are not doing anything to help us. We are going to have war with our own people.
But see, what you have to do earlier, you made a statement, Rosie. You asked about what should you have to do and about something going in the community. What black folks have to do is to go back today and start renegotiating. Here's the word I'm going to give you, renegotiate. You have to start renegotiating your relationship. Black America must renegotiate its relationship with its own elected officials. They must renegotiate their relationship with major white corporations. They must renegotiate their relationship with the media in this country, both the print and electronics. They have to renegotiate their relationship with political parties and saying that we ain't going for the okey-doke anymore. And tell these people in the communities and everybody, all the businesses in your community, renegotiate the relationship with them and say that we do not see you effectively doing anything to support our people in this community or buying time on a black radio station or doing anything and you're non-black, we will start boycotting. You take flyers. You take flyers and put it on the counter. Put a flyer on the counter of every business in every black community neighborhood and say, look, if you do not participate and support black issues and the needs for black folk, get the hell out of the community.
And absolutely. If you catch a black person patronizing them after you come to that, then we need to find a way to put pain on them. This doesn't make sense at all, Doctor, and it has to be a group effort. We're going to have to make people do right, seeing if they don't know how to do it on their own. The only few black outlets we have, the only few black radio stations can barely make it unless we step up to these businesses. They can't do it. They can't go out and say, well, you have to advertise with me. But we, the consumers, can step up to these businesses and say, if I don't hear an advertisement on this station, we will not be driving through your McDonald's. We will not be driving through your Burger King. We will not be driving to your so-and-so. We have the power to stop this madness, but we will not do it.
Education. Yes. Education is the only way it's going to happen because, all as we know, if blacks don't hear it, they don't respond to it.
But
so
Dr.
we have
Anderson,
to push,
baby,
push, push.
He's been doing this for 40 years. I've been bringing him out here to L.A. He's been coming. What do we do? Hearing isn't enough. You know how when your kids, they hear what you say, and eventually you have to pull that paddle out and pat them on that butt? Yes. Somebody
will
have to
hit
somebody.
We should have rallies again. We should start doing rallies. We should set up in the parks.
But how do you do it? Okay, let me explain to you, because I do a lot of stuff. When you do a rally, you don't have one radio station that you're paying, basically, can put it on there. You have no way to distribute that you're having, even to your black churches, if it's not about religion. You can't get that kind of stuff in there. But let me respond to some emails. And sister, I hope you always continue to listen to our show.
And we have another caller too.
Yeah, we have another caller. And for those who didn't hear, this show is going to air again at 7 o'clock. What time? 7 p.m.
Pacific
Coast
Pacific
time. Those who are interested in getting this show, they can email me at Dr. Rosie, DRROSIE @AOL.com. We will make this broadcast available. And we have someone say, I am census 15 poverty rate swells to nearly 1 in 6 census. U.S. poverty rate rises to 15.5%. Number of uninsured hits a high of 49.9. This is something that someone just emailed in to us, and I pay no attention to the stuff that the media and the propaganda they put out, because whenever they tell you, they're not even talking about us, and the figure is never accurate. We're basically 3 times whatever they try to put out. We want to take a call and come back to Dr. Anderson. We got an email from Amafika. He wanted to let people, mean to tell the listener how they can get copies of today's broadcast, because he realized how important this is, and they can email Dr. Rose at AOL.com. Go ahead, caller.
Caller.
Go ahead. Caller.
I guess they stepped away from the phone.
Okay
we have a email from Uncle Tom. It says, I think the 2012 election will come down to Governor Rick Perry and Obama. The main issue will not be about the economy, but rather issues of faith. Perry will give white folks the blood call that George Bush gave.
Okay, you want to tackle that one?
You talking to me?
Yeah.
No, who would care? I wouldn't care at least. I see. I've run. See, most of these people give me all these opinions about politics. I've never been in politics. See, I've run campaigns. I've been a campaign chairman for governors, for presidents, for mayors, for congresspeople, and for state representatives and attorney generals. I have planned Democratic conventions, presidential conventions in Atlanta, Georgia, and co-deputy up here in Maryland for President Clinton. See, everybody's telling you, getting all these opinions about power, knowing what the hell they're talking about.
Right.
Politics is useless if you don't have power and wealth and resources.
Yes.
Don't get caught up in that game. Don't worry about it. I don't give a damn what they talk. They want to talk about state rights. Let them talk about it. You just go back to your communities. That's what these Asians do. Asians are trying to run for intermediary offices. What they're trying to do is try to move into every community and build communities and build wealth and power for themselves. They don't get involved in politics. You don't see the American Indians out here trying to hold demonstrations and marching around moaning, "We shall overcome someday." They're trying to take these reservations and get as much wealth and power as they can on those reservations with gambling, casinos, and everything else. The only people who are silly enough to keep trying to play these little political games are black folk and trying to integrate. Nobody else wants to integrate but black folk. You cannot, listen to me and underscore this five times, you cannot win in politics if you're a planned, systematic, institutionalized minority. The first act of Congress in 1790 was to pass a naturalization law, which says that black folks should be, which is a zero quota on blacks coming in this country. You are a planned minority. And in a society where the majority will win and rule and the minority will win and lose. Voting at right now, you're outnumbered 8-1 by whites in the polls. 8-1. Do you know how many times 8 will go across 1 with nothing left over? And now Hispanics are coming to this country in the last 30 or 40 years, and now Hispanics have surpassed you. Now they got 42 million Hispanics in the country and 40 million blacks. Hispanics could wipe you out on any election, neutralize you out. Why you can keep messing around with politics? That is a waste of time. You outnumber 9-1.
Politics.
And Rosie, it's an easy way of explaining to you, the simplified way so all your listeners understand. It's like throwing a rabbit over into a pen with a bunch of 9 hungry bulldogs, and giving them all the right to vote on what they're gonna have for lunch. And you got a rabbit and 9 hungry dogs. They're gonna eat the rabbit. Or you got 9 Ku Klux Klanmen gonna vote with 1 black in the room of who they're gonna lynch.
What I'm saying is, right now the politics don't even work for white folks nowadays.
Why do you keep messing around with it? They're gonna run you out again, tell you to go out and vote for put a person in office, but you ain't gonna get a damn bit of benefits. Politics is a process that decides who gets what benefits. If you don't get any benefits, don't play. And you choose between one another. No, you don't. You do what I told you in Powernomics, and tell them about the books. Powernomics chapter 7 says, if you get into a conflict between which party, the Republican Party, the Democratic Party, the Liberal, Conservative, you create your own damn party and run an independent party. Exactly. And all blacks vote as a block and say, we don't care who runs for office. We will vote for and support the person that would promise the most and deliver to black folk. That is power, not expensive.
Dr. Anderson, you know what we say. We say we need to hold them accountable. And the question for me, accountable for what? What did they promise you? What did you ask them for? Okay,
you got a caller from 313.
Okay, you got to make a promise.
Caller from 313. Go ahead.
I'm alumni of the School of Hard Knocks. I am the son and grandson of Pullman Porters, the grandson of a cook on the train.
Okay, do you have a
railroad
question?
People.
Come on, you got to ask
and
a question.
I think about sometimes, we live in a land of
Harry.
You're
living in a land where...
Harry, you're not from 313. We're taking the caller from 313 first. Caller, 313.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Hello, everybody, and Dr. Anderson. This is Michael M. Hotel from the African History Network. I just want to thank you all for having this brother on. I know you all are tired. I can hear the pain in your voice, Sister Rosie. And Dr. Rosie, and I let a lot of my listeners know about this show last night. I told them to tune in. But one thing that we have to utilize, and this may help you, Dr. Rosie, I know it's hard. I deal with Negroes here in Detroit also. So if I had hair, I'd be pulling it out. But We have more at our disposal today than ever before to communicate with our people. We have social media, Facebook, mm-hmm. Twitter, things like that, YouTube. So those are excellent mediums to get that information out. And at the same time, our children consume so much media a day, it's like in the perfect form to get that information to them. So there are some inroads being made. Everybody's not going to get it. Even when slavery ended, you had slaves that wanted to stay on the plantation. They didn't want to be free. Okay, so we just have to understand that. I don't want to take up too much of your time, but I just want to let you know that. And, you have people that are supporting you, Dr. Anderson, you have people that are supporting you. Hopefully you can come back to Detroit. How was that, African Liberation Day, when you came here a few months ago, Dr. Anderson?
Yes, sir, I remember that.
I watched you. Yeah,
right.
I was here, man. So hopefully we can bring you back again, brother. You know we need help in Detroit. A lot of our leadership has sold us out, man, with the exception of, Joanne Watson and a few other people. So, but you all go ahead, keep up what you're doing, and definitely utilize social media to network, because, I mean, with just a few keystrokes, you can empower hundreds of thousands of our people at one time.
And I like what you said, how you sent out the notice for other people to listen to the show. But we don't have the major media. So this is ours right now, as long as they don't try to stop it. So when we have something like this, everybody need to make sure that everybody across this country, a lot of people with email, but I understand what you're saying, but I think I feel like Harry Tubman. I'm about ready to get my gun and start pointing at people.
There's a way to get it to major media if you wanted to get it to major media. See, all the major media, MSNBC, CNN, all the various shows, they have Facebook and Twitter pages. So you can go on there, and they pay attention to what you talk about. I listen to a lot of media because I'm a talk show host also. I listen to a lot of media. I listen to Reverend Al Sharpton's show. Usually I'm tuned in, but I ain't listening now because I'm listening to you all. But Reverend Al Sharpton interviewed somebody. It was either Reverend Al or Warren Valentine. They interviewed an executive with a high-ranking executive with NBC. She was African-American female. And she said, if you want to get information to us, if you want to see certain types of programming, things like that, she said, we pay attention to our Facebook pages and our Twitter pages. If you're on there talking about different things that you want, and it's like a lot of you doing that, we pay attention to that.
Hey,
you understand that.
Do me a favor. Email me at drrosa@aol.com, okay?
Okay.
We got a caller. We have another caller.
I will.
Email me.
Okay, peace.
Okay. Go ahead,
Carla. 626. Oh, it was Carla again. I had gotten knocked off the air, and I was trying to listen to you guys, and I didn't know if the program was still on.
It's still on, yeah.
Okay.
You got another question, Carl, or are you just listening?
He just listening.
I was just listening.
Okay.
Rosie. Yeah. I thought you wanted to discuss that plan, too, about what it's about. Somebody inquired about the plan.
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah,
the Obama plan.
Right.
Yeah, please do. We're supposed to get back.
I can't talk about the whole plan, but I'll tell you about sections of the plan very quickly.
Uh-huh.
The first thing was saying basically that if you really want to stimulate jobs in the country very quickly, the first thing that Obama should do is try to create a Marshall Plan for these urban areas. I would call it urban redevelopment or revitalization policy, like the Marshall Plan of World War II or the Point 4 plan that was instituted in Japan. This country revitalized both Europe and Japan by pouring in millions and millions of dollars to rebuild their infrastructure and build businesses and industries for them and supply them with resources after World War II. You need a similar plan. The first thing you need is to be revitalized in these 10 urban cities in the United States. You got 10 major black cities where blacks are the dominant majority population. Those cities are like jungles. They are the most dangerous, worst, weak, poverty-stricken, crime-ridden cities in the entire United States. They got an unemployment population of over 50% of the blacks in those cities. 48% in Detroit, 48% in Baltimore, 49% in Pittsburgh, 52% of the blacks in New York are unemployed, and 89% of the black youth. And nobody cares. If you want to create some unemployment opportunities, come up with an urban regional revitalization program and get you a czar, and appoint a czar for the president to oversee it. And put independent revolving loan, low-interest loan banks in those cities where people can go and borrow low-interest money and put in industries. And then get them incentives to attract businesses and industries back in those cities, but try to get the local population, the black population, to build their own businesses. That can be easily done. That was called Urban Revitalization, a Marshall Plan for the 10 large urban cities in the United States for the indigenous population, which would be primarily blacks. And right now you got 25 million unemployed people in America. About 10 million of those are blacks, and those 10 million are living in and around those large cities. 70% of all the blacks in America live around 10 large cities, which are urban cities. That's where you should have started with your redevelopment plan for trying to create jobs. It would have been knocked off. You got rid of half of the damn unemployment problem just in those urban cities. The plan that Obama has now will only create about 2 million jobs in about the next 3 years. He could have created about 20 times that much in about 2 years by going in and revitalizing those urban cities. Another plan was to stop, to come up with a public policy that says we will never invade another country and quit and bombing other countries unless you're going to get reciprocity agreements. Right now we're bombing Iraq and Iran and Libya and all those countries and Afghanistan. When you go into these countries, you have a policy that says for every dollar we spend in your country, we plan on bringing back that much in value and resources back to our country. We have spent about $4 trillion now over there. We've been spending $10 billion a month in Afghanistan and not getting a damn thing for it. You should be bringing back trillions of dollars worth of oil for this country and building haulers, the ships to bring it back, creating jobs, building refineries, storage tanks underground, storing the oil, building refineries, processing it. And you would drive down the gas rate in this country down about 5 cents a gallon because you have enough oil to be able to supply the needs of all your people. There are all kind of creative ways to create wealth and revenue and to create jobs in that plan I wrote for Obama, but I don't have time to go through it. But those are just two of them I just mentioned to you.
Okay, we have a caller.
That was awesome. Those who listen, I'm telling you, you can see that there is a way out. If anybody's home, if the lights are on. So what Dr. Anderson have laid out, I think you need to get that letter and send it to all your representatives. Those who don't know how to do that, you can go to my website, www.9114blackamerica.com, and click where it says your representative, and just click that and put your zip code in, and you can get the phone number and address to everybody who represents you. And I think you need to get on the horn, because this Dr. Anderson have put out a plan, and it will definitely work. Talking about the, you know, most of us in the major cities, and that's where it's hard to hit. So it seems it would make sense, Dr. Anderson, to revitalize these cities, except you don't care about people who look like me. Go ahead, Carla. Carla?
Yes, hi. Hello?
Yes,
what's your name and where you calling from?
I'm calling from Brentwood, New York. My name is Lena.
Okay.
I was just listening to the brother a few minutes ago talking about the Obama job plan. Mm-hmm. And even though he says a lot of good points, I've realized a lot of us don't understand finances to begin with. So unless
you're on with someone that does.
Unless people start getting into learning first personal finance, there's no way they could own businesses or do anything else. And I think
you're with two people that understand that. So.
Yeah, we understand that very well.
Yeah, everybody understands people have any finance. There are ways of accumulating your wealth, pooling your wealth. And you learn how to pool your wealth and you build your own business and industries, and you loan money to your people in your own group. And you don't charge them any interest, and you commit yourself to buying the resources from them once they go into business. You go to them first and foremost. You buy locally or buy domestically from your own people first. Make your dollars bounce 8 to 12 times in your own community, your own hand. Right. You don't need that much money. No institution going to lend you any money.
It's coming together. You may have the money, and I may have the brain. When we going to connect?
Yeah. We got a caller from 503 area code. Please go ahead. Make your question quick, please.
Yes, my name is Kobe. I'm from Portland, Oregon.
Uh-huh. Go ahead.
My question to Dr. Anderson is, how do I get in contact with him? Because what I want to do is I want to replicate some of the work that he's put together in terms of his understanding of policies and finance, and I want to spread that around in the discussions that I create with black people. Because I have his books, and I can teach and I can try to share his principles in the book form, but I want people to understand how to understand these things as far as like a political strategy, not simply telling them what we got to do, but sharing with them, you know, how it's actually done.
Okay, that's a good question.
I would suggest that you get Dr. Anderson DVD. live economic justice for blacks. And I would also, Dr. Anderson, give them the Harvest Institute website, because you have articles. You've been telling us for all these years, and everything he has said to us, he made it plain in articles. And you can go to the website and print those articles down free. It go back to 1990, don't it, Dr. Anderson?
Yes, you can go to harvestinstitute.org. harvestinstitute.org, and you can pull down all kinds of articles. Most of those newsletters were about 20 pages in length.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We have another caller. Dr. Anderson?
Rosie?
Yes.
In response to the last lady that called, she was wondering how you get the finance to do any kind of economic development, even if you build communities. You hit it dead on the head. There's four things you need to have. It's like a four-legged stool. Two-legged stools won't stand. A three-legged stool won't stand too well. You got to have four legs. The four legs you need to be able to do the things she's asking about, you're going to need the financing is one. You need money. Two, you need to have some political connection. Three, you need to have resources available to you. And four, you need to have some skills. And what black folks need to do when they started forming their groups to try to figure out how to develop these businesses, you don't have to have all four of those things. You just have your team. Building an economy is a team activity. It's a team sport. One person might have the finance, and another one understands, has the political contacts, other might have access to the resources, and the other might have the skills of being able to do it. And that's what's happening with us in our community. We don't go together as a team and right. play as a team. We're the only group of people that want to go out on the football field and play as individuals rather than as a team and a team sport. Racism is a team sport. You either play as a team or you lose.
Oh, there was a question on the board, Dr. Anderson, and something that you mentioned. You said by 2015 that if we didn't get our act together, that black folks were doomed, they were going to start dying.
That's right. Right now, they're dying all over the world right now. They're dying right now today. People might tell me about it. You start going to Africa and find how fast the people are dying. You go to India and find out, and in any country, people are dying. They're going to be dying in masses. Go to Somalia right now. Go to your website and go check out find out how many blacks right now dying every day in Somalia, right, or in African countries right now.
Dr. Anderson, do you think it would help? Because that letter, I mean, I was just so moved by it. I was just up for days reading it over and over. Do you think that it would help if that newsletter is placed on the site? Well, I think everybody should send that, because maybe your representative don't have a clue about what can be done. You have certainly laid the plan out, and I would like to see it in everybody's hand.
Well, Rosie, you're free to do whatever you can do, babe. I don't have any problem with it. Right now, I just reached an age now that I'm just tired. I'm tired and sick and tired of being sick and tired of asking black folks to play as a team. I'm tired of it. I can do a lot of things as an individual, and I've climbed mountains and then most blacks would never even dream of climbing. I've been successful as an individual. But if it doesn't translate back to black folks, like I told you with Oprah and Tiger Woods' money, if it doesn't translate back to help black folks, it's useless. And I've tried to take all my collective experiences in education and politics and government and the Marine Corps and the pilot and everything else to try to help black folks. That's why I write all my books to be cookbooks, recipes, roadmaps, blueprints to help black folks get out of their dilemma. But half of them don't read.
Yeah,
and the rest don't care.
Saying, Dr. Anderson, you're saying as a group, because we look at the money. Sure, some people say, well, yeah, she built a school in Africa, but we're talking about collectively pooling the money together to help a group, not just for one cause. That's what you're talking about, right?
That's right. That's absolutely right. And see, and if you really want to help black folk, you don't have to go all the way around Africa and put up a school for girls in Africa. Why don't you go build a school for some of these black people right here in the United States? I get sick and tired of black folk trying to tell me how many black kings sat on the throne of Egypt. And how is that going to help black folk right now fighting in an alley in Detroit trying to survive? You need to put any information you put out, anything you do needs to be relevant to today's time to help these people survive and prosper today.
And so should our education. I can't say it enough. You cannot be just comfortable because you're sending your child to school every day, whether it's high school, college, whatever. You got to step in and see, are they taking something? Are they being prepared to lead themselves out of this slavery that we have sold ourselves into? You have to ask these questions.
And see, if they don't do it, if we don't build an economy, they can go to college and get all the education they want. They can still be unemployed. Because you still got to go to a white person in a white community and a white business to get a job, and they will determine your value. Because you don't have your own business in the economy. Every black child should be able to go get an education.
and learn as best that he can of his skills that he will need to survive and be able to come back to his own community and to his own businesses and propel him to be competitive businesses around the world.
Keith, I think you have a message on the board.
It says you have had callers from coast to coast today, from Portland, Oregon to upstate New York. Internet radio can work with proper promotions and some minor technical knowledge on the part of the listener. Interlight Radio is the best of the independent-owned radio stations that I've heard. More folks need to learn about it and protect it. And this comes from Don Tone in Houston, Texas.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Dr. Anderson, I can't thank you enough because I know all the work that you have to do. And for you to take this time, you know, to come on and share your knowledge with us, I want you to know that I don't take it for granted at all. I will get that letter posted on my 911 website, and people can go to it and they can send it. I think it's critical because a lot of people representing us, Dr. Ann, they cannot understand what you have in that letter. The Black Caucus, a lot of our other people, they cannot understand what you have in this letter if they have not moved on it. I haven't heard this perspective put out in a place. So, I mean, they're not coming to you to ask you, but since you put it out there, I think it's up to all of us to make sure you will be doing them a favor and doing us a favor. What do you think,
Keith? Well, I agree with you, and obviously I would love to be able to help the Congressional Black Caucus and in general, but also in particular help our black president. But again, they have to understand there are creative ways and ideas that they can use to put in effect to lift the quality of life for the entire country, but also for black folk, where black folk can be economically more stable and satisfying in their lifestyles. But nobody wants to do it because nobody wants to dress anything black. And that's why I said if you put the plan out and also promote the books. Tell them right now anything you want to learn about what I've said and done, to go to the website, powernomics.com, and they can order. Yes. The Powernomics books and the Black Labor, White Wealth, and those Dirty Little Secrets books. Those books would take them. Each book would take them through about 10 years of history in a university. Each book would contain about that much history for them, and read and understand the issues.
Using it as a study guide. Of those who are listening, you need to get these books. I believe it's Chapter 6 in Powernomic. Anybody who are trying to deal with that community and know what they need to do to have a community, you need to read these books. It's already there, you know. So it's so important. And I just appreciate, Dr. Anderson, what you're doing. And I know this plan will work. And people just, if you read it, because look at it like this. If you can help these major cities where a majority of black people live, everybody hurt. When there's illiteracy, if our children can't read, if we're unemployed, once the country understands that we're in this thing together, and if we don't win, the country can't win.
Amongst our circle, they're saying, you know, we're saying that blacks need to leave those metropolitan areas.
No, we don't.
Yes, we do. We need to leave those areas because they're not working for us.
But where are we going?
Well, there's tons of land.
If you don't have any money, don't care where you go, it's not going to work for you.
Between the two of you, here's the great sadness about it, is that whites got about four concepts they're going to use to take back these urban areas anyway. They got one called gentrification, they got another one called regional forms of government, another one called metropolitan forms of government, another one called cool cities, where that's where they bring gays into your community and let them build communities. Mm-hmm. And Bloomberg right now is asking President Obama to start bringing in more illegal immigrants from Mexico and dropping them into Detroit, and so they can begin to build industry, take over the city of Detroit and provide jobs and businesses for themselves. That's Mayor Bloomberg of New York. That's been highly publicized in the papers. But we have to understand one thing. If you're going to solve those problems in this country, whether you're with the Congressional Black Caucus or you're in the White House as a president, there are only three things that any given individual can do to earn a living. It's just that simple. There are only three things you can do to earn a living in this country. You either work or have a business at the top. And if for whatever reason you can come up with, if you cannot have a business or a job at the top, you're forced to go down to the second level. You must go down then and seek welfare or handouts or be sent out on the street corner begging for coins. If you can't do that, then you must go down to the third level. The third level, you must commit crime and steal and rob to do it. You must do an elaboration, combination, or sophistication, those three things, unless you got some kind of magical portion where your butt can disappear.
Mm. Wow.
This is Carl. I just wanted to say one other thing.
Go ahead, Carl.
First off, I got to thank the three of you guys because you gave me a lot of ideas, okay? And basically, Dr. Anderson, what you've done, I mean, is, like I said, I was able to use to create two success cases. For instance, when people come over to fix, you know, they come over to fix the appliance, or I had an exterminator the other day to get rid of some ants, I went the extra length to make sure that it was either someone who was black working there or someone who owns it, okay, which is very rare. One of the reasons being is because, as an economist, I'm able to show him how to rebalance his 401k or whatever so he can use the money to actually own the company, okay? Little things like that. Little things when I saw the Hispanics working on someone's car. There's a lot of youth out there that need that kind of talent, the skills to be able to fix things, to do things, so they can create their own business. There's one term you said on one of your lectures that I play it over and over, and you said the word aggregate. When you guys were talking about a community, of course, physically, we don't have that community. But as I was hearing my brother from Black Talk Network talk, we have a cyber community. Whatever community we have to reach folks to actually put it together an economy, which is nothing more than time, till, task, and toil, i.e. time, the till, money that you put into it, the task that gets it done, and the toil, the actual work. If we put that into the cyber community or any other community, I think that is a grand step. But again, I have to thank the three of you guys because you gave me so many ideas.
And Carl, okay, what good. You can do and when you're talking about auto mechanic, then we need to be in our schools demanding that these things that our people need to learn to make a living for themselves, we can't expect them to do it. They do it in other communities. We have to decide, that Dr. Anderson said, if it's our community, then we need to decide what you're teaching our children.
That's right.
Rose, I got to get off.
But let me tell you this in conclusion. Let all your listeners understand, it's not about hating anybody else. So I do not want them to hate whites or any other group. It's about competing. When the Washington Redskins play the Dallas Cowboys, they don't hate the members of the other team. They learn how to compete and win. Racism means you overcome racism because it's a race. A race is a competitive relationship between groups of people who are competing to get ownership and control of resources, wealth, and power. You got to learn how to get out there and compete. And don't be afraid to compete in the name of your own team. We're the only people on earth that are scared to compete for our blackness. And whether they like it or not, in conclusion, God has arbitrarily assigned them to a skin color team. You either play as a team or you lose by default, and that's about it. And I'm older now, and I don't want to waste any more time keep telling black folk the same damn thing over and over and over again. I've been doing it for 40 years. You all have a pleasant day now.
Dr. Anderson, thank you so much. Thank you so much. Keith, this has been a wonderful show. Those who listen, remember, if you didn't get a chance, what time tonight, Keith?
7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time.
Yes, and you can hear it all over again. Keith, thank you so much. You're just so awesome.